pogledajte nebo puno zvijezda. Odaberite svoju. Neka ona bude vaša vodilja, vaš dio beskrajnog prostranstva. Upravo tu, ispod tog zvijezdanog neba, nalazi se planeta koju zovemo Dom. Upoznajmo je zajedno. Krenimo na put oko svijeta. U prošloj emisiji pokazali smo vam detalje plovidbe kroz Suetski kanal, uzbudljivu etapu epskog putovanja prve bosansko-hercegovačke ekspedicije oko svijeta. U egipatskoj luci Port Said, na samom ulazu u kanal, upoznali smo Nagiba, vlasnika agencije Felix, čiji nam je topli doček ostao u najljepšem sjećanju. Put nas je potom odveo do Kaira, jedne od najvećih svjetskih metropola i drevne Gize, u kojoj se nalaze čuvena Keopsova piramida i Sfinga. Bili smo i u Sharm el-Sheikhu, gdje smo doživjeli prvu manju nepriliku sa lokalnim vlastima. Uživanje u posjeti Dom Marini, gdje smo nenadano prisustvovali koncertu poznate libanonske pjevačice Miriam Fares, nije pomutila ni zabrinutost zbog kvara na brodskom motoru, problema s kojim smo vas ostavili na kraju prošle epizode. Još uvijek smo u Egiptu i pred nama je Luksor, najatraktivnije i turistički najposjećenije mjesto na planeti. Luksor je smješten na desnoj obali Nila, na području drevne Tebe koja se pružala između današnjeg Luksora i Karnaka. Naziv grada Luksora potječe od arapske riječi El-Luksor, što znači tabor ili utvrda. Dolina Kraljeva danas je, zajedno sa piramidama u Gizi, najznamenitije i najviše posjećeno mjesto u Egiptu. Ovdje se nalaze brojne grobnice različitih kraljevskih dinastija Egipta. Jedna od posebnosti ovog prostora jeste njegova specifična geografska pozicija, čija je dobra zaštićenost od eventualnih napada osvajača zasigurno opredijelila drevne egipatske faraone da ovu dolinu izaberu za svoje vječno počivalište. U Karnaku se nalazi najveći kompleks hramova, čuvena aleja Sfingi, prekrasne obelisce od crvenog granita, te monumentalni stubovi i zidovi sa uklesanim slikama egipatskog života iz tog davnog razdoblja. Upoznajte hram Karnak, a za više informacija pobrinut će se simpatični vodič Ibrahim, čiji entuzijazam nadomještava slabo poznavanje engleskog jezika.
So this is the temple of Karnak. Karnak is the Arabic name of the village. In an Arabic and hieroglyphic to say the north and the south, it's Resit and Isut. So there are two temples here, one here in the north and one there 3 kilometers from here in the south. So the names of these temples, Ebit Isut and Ebit Resit. Ebit, which means bait in Arabic, similar to the Arabic word, which means house. So this is the northern house, which means Ebit Resit in hieroglyphic. This is the name of the temple in the ancient times. The other temple that we are going to see from outside, Ebit Isut. Luxor is the Arabic name, because Luxor, which means palaces. The Arabs thought that these temples had been the palaces of the ancient kings. This became the name of the city. We have another name. We have two more names. We have Thebes, the Greek name, only 600 BC. The Greeks, not just Alexander the Great, 332 BC. 600 BC, the Greeks built the Greek city. They made coins for the first time in the history. They wrote the Odessa. And they made a new name for this city, Thebes. The ancient name that we will see on the temples, on the walls, is Wasit. Looks like number one in English. We will see this name of this ancient city everywhere on the temples, on the buildings here. So you can see the entrance. This is the newest building. It's unfinished. You can notice that one tower is higher than the other. The ancient Egyptians used to make symmetry in their buildings. What they put on the right side, they put on the left side. But here, unfinished. You can feel it. You can notice. because they built it during the end of this civilization, 100, 200 BC. But the eldest building, when was it built? 2000 BC. I mean, they built this temple in 2000 years. 32 different kings. Each king you should build a building. Here and there around the old area, finally became a very big dwelling, 1 kilometer long. And one kilometer per 1 kilometer, well, about 1 million square meter. A city was built in 2000 years. During the Middle Kingdom, the New Kingdom, until the end of this civilization. We can go now to see the entrance.
Do danas su u Dolini Kraljeva otkrivena 62 groba, od kojih su najpoznatiji grobnica Ramzesa I, Ramzesa II, Ramzesa III i Tutankamonova grobnica. Pored toga, tu su i brojne statue bogova i božanstava koja su poštovali drevni Egipćani.
Looks like the designs of Dali, head of Ram and the body of lion. This is the god, god Amon, which means the hidden. The ancient Egyptians believed that there is a god who lives in the sky. He looks like a ram, like this, and the body of lion. Fertile head and the strength, the body of the strength. This is Amun. Amun has a wife, the name of his wife Mut. He has a son, the name of his son Khonsu. This is the triad of this city, of the city of life. There in the city of dead, in the valley of the kings, Osiris, Isis and Horus, another triad. The god here, we will see him like a ram. We will see him like a man, has two feathers on his head. We will see him as a ball. We will see him as a duck, as a goose. Five different representations of the god of this temple. The best sphinx to see, a beautiful sphinx, a very preserved one. The second one on the left hand. For a nice photograph, the second sphinx. Almost under the head of the god, there is a little statue. This is the statue of the king, which means that the god is protecting the king.
That's look there, the complete sphinx, the most preserved one, beautiful.
Grobnice egipatskih kraljeva imale su brojne jednostavne ili kompleksne samoodbrambene mehanizme koji su trebali obeshrabriti i onemogućiti eventualne provalnike i pljačkaše grobova. Interesantno je čuti nešto više o graditeljskim tehnikama ovog drevnog naroda i uvjeriti se da dobra ideja ponekad vrijedi više od najmodernije krana.
The Egyptians to build a big wall like this, how they prepare the ground? How did they prepare the ground? What kind of foundations they used to make? They should dig about 7 meters. They put first 1 meter of sand to make the wall flexible during the earthquakes. After this, they fill this foundation with stones, one on the other, until they arrive to the level of the ground to put the first stone you can see, the first visible stone. They should file it, clean it like glass, and they file the next stone the same, and they put one on the other without any cement or glue. Like two pieces of glass, when you put them, you can't pull one from the other. The same idea. Then they make a ramp, a little ramp, to roll the next stone. The same idea. They file it and they put it on it, on the last one. And they make the ramp longer and bigger to roll more stones, more stones. Finally, they get all the building on the ramps here and there because they roll as one stone from here and one stone from there, one from here, one from there. Finally, they get all the building on the ramps. Why they built all these temples? For their prayers. And this is the dwelling of the king as well. The kings spent most of their life here in this dwelling. A lot of furniture, a lot of statues, a lot of things, but everything now in the museum. In one museum abroad, not in Egypt, in Italy, the Museum of Turin, they have 150,000 objects, Egyptian objects.
Posebnost ovog područja koje svojom fascinantnom arhitekturom plijeni pažnju posjetilaca iz cijelog svijeta su veliki stubovi koji imaju kapitele u obliku papirusa. Visoki su 19 metara, a opseg im je gotovo 10 metara. Pred ovakvim zdanjima čovjeku jednostavno zastane dah.
We will go to see now 134 columns had been built in one century by three different kings. Ramses II, his father, Sitis I, and Amenophis III, the father of Akhenaton, the monotheist of ancient Egypt, the husband of Nefertiti, the famous statue of Berlin. In Berlin Museum, there is a famous statue of Queen Nefertiti. She's the wife of Akhenaton. Akhenaton is the son of Amenophis III. So Amenophis III, Ramses II, Sitis I, his father, built this hall in 100 years.
Interesantno je da se najveći egipatski obelisk zapravo nalazi u Italiji, tačnije u Rimu, ali još je interesantnije čuti kako su ove kamene gromade transportovane. Još jednom ćemo se uvjeriti da su drevni Egipćani imali rješenje za svaki problem.
The biggest Egyptian obelisk now in Rome. The second biggest Egyptian obelisk, this one, 322 tons. Should be one piece, the obelisk, granite. The ancient Egyptians...
Everything was piece.
Should be one piece. The ancient Egyptians, to get granite, they should go to Aswan, 220 kilometers from here to the south. Aswan became an area of volcanoes millions of years ago. Volcanoes carried up granite, diorite, dolerite, three different igneous stones, three different volcanic stones. How to put it on the water of the Mediterranean? Or how did they put it on the surface of the water of the river, the ancient Egyptians and the Romans? They make a lock. They dig a canal from the water to the water. If the water is a river or a sea, they dig a canal and they put two gates. And on the dry land of the canal, before they get the water inside the canal, into the canal, on the ground of the canal, they build a very big boat. And they roll the obelisk. They put it on the boat. Then they open the gates. The water carries the boat slowly, slowly. When they arrive to the level of the water of the river or of the sea, they take the boat to the sea. They arrive. And then how to get the obelisk, this big piece of stone, again from the surface of the water to the land? They dig another canal, the same idea. Look, they empty the water, they arrive to the land, and then they start rolling the stone to put it here.
U neposrednoj blizini Doline Kraljeva je hram kraljice Hatshepsut, podignut u zapadnoj Tebi 1466. godine prije Krista. Terasastom strukturom na različitim nivoima postignut je sklad između građevine i prirodnog okruženja. Stari su ga Egipćani nazivali Geser Geser ili najuzvišeniji među uzvišenima. Posebnost ovog hrama je u činjenici da je uklesan u stijeni. Monumentalni kompleks djelo je arhitekta Senmata, a izgradnja istog potvrdila je pravo kraljice Hatshepsut da postane vladaricom unatoč činjenici što je bila žena.
A very strong earthquake happened in Egypt, 27 BC. BC. Strabion, a historian, was here in Egypt. He told us a lot about this earthquake. Destroyed one of the obelisks of Queen Hatshepsut. So this is the other one. We will see the top of the other one near the lake.
Premda su drevni Egipćani bili napredna civilizacija koja je poznavala tehniku izrade papirusa, primitivnog papira, najznačajnije pisane tragove svoje kulture ostavili su uklesane u mnogo solidnijem materijalu granitnih zidova.
This wall looks like a journal, a newspaper or a magazine, an old magazine. They told us here the story of the conflict between Hatshepsut and her nephew Thutmose III. Are there troubles and problems between the different relatives in ancient Egypt in these families? Happened sometimes, especially the conflict of Hatshepsut and Thutmose III. He came here and he defaced the pictures of his aunt. This is what you can see there when you go. You will see some defaced pictures.
Drevno egipatsko pismo čine hieroglifi, slikovne oznake kojim se predstavljaju imena i brojevi. Vidjet ćemo kako su drevni Egipćani pisali broj 1000, a naš vodič Ibrahim, koji čini se zna biti i duhovit, govori o načinu na koji bi se mogao napisati broj milion.
This is 1000 in hieroglyphic. There is 1 million. How to write 1 million in hieroglyphic? A man is raising his hands and is opening his mouth and saying, ooh, too much. This is 1 million in hieroglyphic.
Jedna od životinja koje su drevni Egipćani smatrali svetim bio je skromni insekt iz roda Balegara, kojeg su nazivali Skarabej. Vjerovalo se da upravo on upravlja putanjem sunca na način na koji kotrlja i svoj vječni teret. Naravno, i Skarabej ima svoj kip, a vjeruje se da će vam šetnja oko njega donijeti sreću i novac. Šta više, postoji i tačna računica.
There is a Skarabej there. If you walk around it, it will bring you good luck.
Yeah.
Okay, if you walk around one time, you get $1 per day.
Okay.
1,000 times, $10,000 per day.
Okay.
Is that true?
No, we talk about millions.
Ah, it's millions.
1 million.
Okay.
Once 1 million.
So for 1 million, we have to walk around 1 million times.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Nakon što smo optrčali počasni krug oko Skarabeja, idemo dalje. Hoćemo li zbog toga u budućnosti imati više novca, ostaje nam da vjerujemo. Ako ga i ne bude, nećemo žaliti. Posjeta Luksoru bila je nagrada sama po sebi. Pustinja je ista kao i more. Na izgled beskrajno prostranstvo talasastog pijeska iz kojeg se izdižu kamenite planine, nazubljene i oštre poput noža, predstavlja poseban svijet dovoljan sam sebi. Ispod vječnog sunca, koji zajedno sa vjetrom hiljadama godina kleše i oblikuje ovaj dio planete, ostavljajući ga ogoljenim do srži, buja život kojeg na prvi pogled nije lako primijetiti. Ovo je svijet pustinskih slobodnjaka, dom jedne izuzetno vitalne ljudske zajednice čiji je život određen posebnim pravilima. Vrijeme se ovdje ne mjeri satom i kalendarom. Vrijeme je ovdje posebno fluidna forma čiji ritam određuju izlasci i zalasci sunca, ritam života. Iako cijeli pejzaž izgleda kao zaleđen u vremenu, vrijeme je nešto što se ne da zaustaviti, curi poput pijeska između prstiju. I putovanje pustinjom jednako je uzbudljivo kao plovidba otvorenim morem. Pred tobom je toliko mogućih puteva od kojih svaki vodi negdje, što ti daje tako veliki osjećaj slobode, nešto što moraš doživiti. Zamijenili smo brod za snažne motocikle, pustinske krstarice, koje su nas odnijele do beduinskog sela. Siguran sam da su nas primijetili davno prije nego smo se pojavili na obzoru. Izdao nas je oblak prašine kojeg smo ostavljali za sobom. Beduini od Maroka do Jemena žive istim načinom života. Navike i običaje ovih ljudi skoro da su isti kao i prije 2000 godina. Ratovanje i stočarstvo su glavna zanimanja beduina. Pored osjećaja slobode i nezavisnosti, gostoljublja i zadane riječi, beduin se ponosi svojim lijepim i čistim jezikom, kojeg se mitolozi smatraju najbogatijim i najharmoničnijim jezikom na svijetu. Veoma pažljivo biraju riječi koje ostavljaju snažan utisak. U dobroj mjeri njihov je život danas podređen interesovanjima turista, koji ovdje često i rado svraćaju u potrazi za duhom nekih starih vremena. Stoga je tu i turistički vodič koji nam pojašnjava životnu rutinu ovih fascinantnih ljudi.
And for the Muslims people, everybody, they have to pray 5 prayers in the day, every day. And for the Muslims people also, there's one day, is Friday. In Friday, before the second prayer in this day, there's a man make a calling to the pray. And after all the men, they coming to sit in the mosque. And there's one man, he must be right man, he must know all things about the right way in the life. He must know all things about the Prophet Muhammad. And also this man, he speak with everybody like speech. I mean, he's speaking and everybody, every man who is sitting in the mosque, they must listen to this man, what he talking about. Maybe he choose a small part of Quran to explain it for the people. Maybe he talking about the things what the Prophet Muhammad, he was doing in the life. And also to share for the people where's the right way and where's the wrong way in the life. And also everybody, before anyone go inside the mosque to pray, there's some place with water. The Muslims people, they're going to washing the body.
أشهد أن محمد رسول الله.
Čista i snažna vjera u ovom surovom pustinskom svijetu uz hranu i vodu predstavlja suštinski uslov opstanka. Beduini su vječne skitnice i nikada na jednom mjestu ne ostaju dovoljno dugo da bi ostavili konkretne tragove istorije i civilizacije. U prošlosti su ovi ljudi bili veliki ratnici i konjenici. Beduini su istovremeno vladari i podanici, skloni realnom vjerovanju, ali i fikcijama, često nemirni i istovremeno sposobni za najveće stvari. Slobodu i nezavisnost vole iznad svega. Port Galib, trgovački gradić na obali Crvenog mora, u zvaničnim se dokumentima pominje još u 12. vijeku. Gotovo nestvarna ljepota morske obale, bogatstvo koralnih grebena i podvodnog svijeta, te relativna blizina većih gradskih centara, opredijelili su moćne investitore da baš ovdje izgrade jedan od najmodernijih jahting centara u svijetu. Premda je projekat izgradnje marine, više luksuznih hotela te ostalih pratećih sadržaja koji se prostiru na čak 18 km morske obale još uvijek u realizaciji, već se naziru konture potpuno novog grada. Na idejnom projektu izgradnje Las Vegasa Srednjeg istoka, kako već zovu ovo mjesto, radili su neki od najistaknutijih svjetskih stručnjaka, brižljivo vodeći računa o svakom detalju, Od stila arhitekture koja je u potpunosti usklađena sa bogatom tradicijom arapske gradnje do vrhunski isplanirane funkcionalnosti koja krasi najmodernije urbane sredine bilo gdje u svijetu. Port Galib zamišljen je kao živo mjesto, savršeno uklopljeno i povezano sa ostalim centrima ovog regiona koje će svojim posjetiocima moći priuštiti jedinstven doživljaj odmora i zabave. Savršen spoj tradicije i modernog koncepta obezbjeđuje na relativno malom prostoru gotovo neiscrpne mogućnosti turističke ponude. Naravno, sve ovo ima i svoju cijenu koju sebi mogu priuštiti samo oni najdubljeg džepa. Ovdje nas je dočekao šerif Favzi, voditelj projekta izgradnje Port Galiba. Na šerifa nas je uputio Sol Kerzner, moj poznanik iz Južne Afrike, vlasnik Port Galiba i čovjek koji je priča sam za sebe. No poslušajmo najprije šerifovu.
We are in the top point in Port Galib town, which we create this town in the heart of the desert. Start from 6 years ago with the international airport, Mars Alam International Airport, Port Galib International Marina, and we start to complete our construction. We are in the south of Egypt. The border from Sudan, the border with the Sudan is about 400 kilometers. And this is virgin places. Nobody can touch it before 100 years. But our group start to create a new town in the heart of the desert. It was nothing. Mountains, the sand, and it's virgin places. Nobody touched these places. But I think we can create some life inside with a different style, with good thinking about how to attract the people to enjoy with our sun, warm, and the diving, and many things we can offer. This place has a different style because we have a master plan and we never can change the master plan. Everything is with discipline, with the system, the same color, the same height. We want to attract the quality, good quality of people, and I think that it will be the best place for the next 5 or 6 years in Egypt. It will be more better than many places in Egypt because we have our control about the master plan. Yes, I think the hospitality of the Egyptian people, I can say, but you can feel it. You can feel it when you come to Egypt. You will found by yourself. You discover, found out by yourself that the Egyptian people has a very great hospitality. This is a mentality of the Egyptians. They like to help. They like to give you the smile. They like to feel you happy in your staying in Egypt with the warm weather, with a very nice dive sites and corals and ancient of old history of our grandfather, the Pharaohs. And I think I can say anything. You have to come by yourself. You have to come and touch and feel what the impression you have.
Šerif nam je u maniru dobrog domaćina upriličio detaljan obilazak jednog od hotela, pokazavši nam sve njegove brojne sadržaje koji govore kako su njegovi projektanti predvidjeli gotovo sve moguće želje svojih zahtjevnih gostiju. Uskoro će ove hotelske sobe, koje odišu luksuzom, zaposjesti bogati posjetioci iz cijelog svijeta. Unaprijed zamišljam arapske šejke i američke industrijalce, englesku aristokratiju i ostale pripadnike visokog društva koji će ovdje potražiti odmor od svakodnevnih obaveza. Na trenutak smo osjetili kako je biti u koži svjetskih dostojanstvenika i bogataša koji imaju privilegiju ovakvog kraljevskog tretmana. Već se spremamo za nastavak putovanja, u susret novim ljepotama i uzbuđenjima. U narednoj epizodi serijala napuštamo Egipat i krećemo prema Sudanu. Ovdje ćemo posjetiti nacionalni park Sanganeb, čije ga izuzetno bogatstvo morskog i podvodnog života čini posebnim mjestom svjetske prirodne baštine. Vidjet ćete nestvarno lijepe koralne grebene, kojih ovdje ima više od 100, te 100 godina star svjetionik koji se već duže vrijeme nalazi pod zaštitom UNESCO-a. Naučit ćete kako je u ovom dijelu svijeta još uvijek aktuelan primitivni sistem robne razmjene, što je i razumljivo ukoliko vam se prva prodavnica nalazi na udaljenosti od 5 dana hoda. Na putu prema Sudanu, Crveno more pokazalo je svoje drugo lice, priuštivši nam iskustvo plovidbe po izuzetno visokim i snažnim valovima koji su u par momenata nastavak putovanja učinili krajnje neizvjesnim. Budite s nama i za 7 dana. Očekuju vas nova uzbuđenja prve BH ekspedicije na putu oko svijeta.